Hello everyone. Good morning. This is K. Lakshmi Patra. Welcomes you to APRJC family. Today, I will discuss about a regulation of respiratory movements as well as respiratory diseases or disorders. The remaining part of this lesson, breathing and exchange of gases. These two small topics I will discuss today. Okay, first of all, regulation of respiratory movements. Actually, this is done by neural system. That means our nervous system. First of all, medulla oblongata. You have to know and you have to recall the responsibilities, the functions of medulla oblongata, which is the last part of our brain, hind part of our brain, medulla oblongata. Okay. Its main function is to send signals to the muscles that control respiration to cause breathing to occur. Medulla oblongata, actually medulla oblongata is responsible for, it regulating the life sustaining activities. What are the life sustaining activities? Two important activities, life sustaining activities. Number one, heartbeat, and number two, respiration. Moreover, this medulla oblongata is also responsible for reflex actions like vomiting, coughing, sneezing, etc. Okay. There are two regions in the medulla that control respiration. Actually, in respiration cycle, inspiration and expiration, two important things in each respiration cycle, respiratory cycle. There are two regions in medulla that controls respiration. Number one, the ventral respiratory group. The ventral respiratory group, VRG. And next, the dorsal respiratory group, DRG. The ventral respiratory group stimulates expiratory movements and the dorsal group controls mostly inspiratory movements. So, ultimately, the medulla sends signals to the muscles that initiate inspiration and expiration. To the muscles means, to which muscles? Ribcage muscles and diaphragm muscles and abdominal muscles also. These muscles actually involved in the movements of respiration. The muscles which are present in ribcage and the phrenic muscles present in the diaphragm and abdominal muscles. Okay. Parts related to respiratory movements. There are four parts. Actually, there are four parts. Number one, respiratory rhythm center. Respiratory rhythm center, RRC. RRC. And pneumotaxis center, And number three, chemotaxis area in the brain, and the receptors associated to respiration are located in carotid artery and aortic receptors. Okay, first of all, respiratory rhythm center, it is actually located in medulla oblongata of brain. Okay, RRC is primarily responsible for regulation of respiratory movements. Just now I explained you that RRC produces rhythmic nerve impulses that contract the muscles responsible for inspiration and expiration. For inspiration, the ventral respiratory group is responsible, and for expiration, dorsal respiratory group is responsible. Both are located in medulla oblongata. So these two centers constitute respiratory rhythm center, RRC. So RRC produces rhythmic nerve impulses that contract the muscles responsible for inspiration and expiration. And another center, pneumotaxis center, not toxic, pneumotaxis center, present in the upper parts of the pons of the brain stem, present in the upper parts of the pons of the brain stem. Pneumotaxis center sets the duration of inspiration for every respiratory cycle. In other words, neural signals from this center can reduce the duration of inspiration and thereby alter the inspiratory rate. The neural signals from this center can reduce the duration of inspiration and thereby alter the respiratory rate. And also, this pneumotaxis center moderate the functions of RRC. Moderate the functions of RRC. And next, chemosensitive area. Chemosensitive area, that means chemo means chemical. For certain chemicals, this area is very much sensitive. So, chemosensitive area. It is located close to RRC of medulla oblongata and in the pons. Actually, it is located in the pons of the brain stem, but it is very close to RRC of medulla oblongata. This chemosensitive area is also known as central chemoreceptors. Central chemosensitive area. Why it is called like that? Central, because these chemoreceptors are located in the central nervous system. Brain is the first part of the central nervous system, and spinal cord is the next part of the central nervous system. So, this chemosensitive area is located in the brain stem of the brain. So, this chemosensitive area is also called as central chemosensitive area. So, these central chemoreceptors are sensitive to increases in arterial CO2 and decreases in arterial pH. When that pH decreases, if increased hydrogen ions are present, then the pH will decrease. So, the chemoreceptors which are located in the central nervous system in chemosensitive area are sensitive to increases in arterial CO2, and the blood flows in arteries. The blood flows in arteries. In that blood, if CO2 is if CO2 increases and H plus ions, hydrogen ions increases, this is very sensitive to that situation. Next, see here. Increased carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions in the blood flows in arteries. Then this condition activates the central chemosensitive area. Increased carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions in the arterial blood activates this center, chemosensitive area. Then it sends signals to respiratory rhythmic center, RRC. Then the respiratory rhythmic center is the center located in a regulatory center located in medulla oblongata, make necessary adjustment in respiratory process by which these substances can be eliminated. First, the increased carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions in the arterial blood activates this chemosensitive area. Then this chemosensitive area sends signals to the respiratory rhythmic area of medulla oblongata. Then automatically this respiratory rhythmic center make necessary adjustments in respiratory process by which these substances can be eliminated. Next, receptors associated with aortic arch and carotid artery. These are called peripheral chemoreceptors because these receptors are located in the body's organ. That is above the heart, on aortic arch and carotid arteries. These are called peripheral chemoreceptors located on the carotid artery and the aortic arch in the form of clusters of cells, groups of cells. The cells are arranged in groups. Okay, these receptors are sensitive to changes in arterial CO2 and pH. See here, that peripheral chemoreceptors on aortic arch and carotid artery detect the changes in CO2, O2 concentration and pH in the arterial blood. Then, this is sensitive to the changes, this center, peripheral chemoreceptors on aortic arch and carotid artery, sensitive to the changes in carbon dioxide concentration, O2 concentration, and pH in the arterial blood. So increase in the rate, then this peripheral chemoreceptors sends signals to the RRC of medulla. Then respiratory rhythmic center of medulla oblongata sends signals to the respiratory muscles. That means rib cage muscles and diaphragm and the phrenic muscles, which are present in the diaphragm, and abdominal muscles. Then increase in the rate and depth of breathing when their concentration is high in order to eliminate these substances. Okay. Next, homeostatic control of breathing. See here, homeostasis. What is homeostasis? Maintaining the constant internal environment in our body. Maintaining the constant internal environment in body in so many aspects, it is generally usually referred as homeostasis. Okay. blood pH of about 7.4. Stimulus, this is the stimulus. Rising level of CO2 in tissues lowers blood pH. Then it sends signals to the respiratory rhythmic center of medulla oblongata, and from signals from carotid arteries and aorta, because they have the peripheral chemosensitive area. So automatically this RRC sends signals to the rib muscles and diaphragm, increase the rate and depth of ventilation. Automatically the CO2 level decreases, and automatically that CO2 is eliminated from the air, from the lungs. So this is the homeostatic control of breathing diagrammatic representation. Next, respiratory disorders. The diseases related to the human respiratory system, our respiratory system. There are four respiratory disorders or diseases in humans. Number one, asthma. I have given the detailed information about these respiratory diseases related to human, and other occupational respiratory disorders. There are four types of occupational respiratory disorders. For all of them, I have given a detailed information. You must write all these things. You must prepare notes with the help of this PPT. Later, which will be sent to you. Okay, asthma. Okay, due to inflammation of bronchi and bronchioles. This is actually asthma is characterized by the inflammation of bronchi and bronchioles. What is inflammation? What does it mean? Swollen and often painful. Painful. Swollen. Here, type mistake. S-W-O-L-L-E-N. Swollen and often painful. That is the characteristic feature of inflammation. Okay, inflammation of bronchi and bronchioles. And it is characterized by the spasm of smooth muscles present in the walls of bronchi and bronchioles. Inflammation of bronchi and bronchioles, and spasm of smooth muscles present in the walls of bronchi and bronchioles. What does it mean, spasm? Spasm means a sudden, violent, involuntary, without our knowledge, without our conscious, involuntary contraction of a muscle. So, a sudden, violent, involuntary contraction of the muscles which are present in the walls of bronchi and bronchioles, what will happen? It narrows. Next, symptoms. Difficulty in breathing because of sudden, violent, involuntary contraction of the smooth muscles present in the walls of bronchi and bronchioles. Difficulty in breathing and wheezing. Wheezing means breathing with a whistling sound in the chest. And next symptom, coughing. And then in the case of asthma, the allergen causes release of histamine, an organic nitrogenous compound, which causes constriction of the bronchi, leads to difficulty in breathing. And next, reasons for asthma. Actually, it is not mentioned in your textbook, but you need to know what are the reasons for. There are several reasons for asthma. So you need to know. Airborne allergens such as pollen, for example, that pollen grains of Parthenium, causes asthma. So airborne allergens such as pollen, dust mites, mold spores, pet dander, are particles of cockroach waste. Dust mites, mold spores, fungi, spores, microscopic, very minute in size. That with these, if air is polluted, that if that contaminated air is inhaled by us, automatically the symptoms of asthma occurs. Pet dander means the particles of fur, hair and feather of pet animals. That is called dander. And then common cold. Next, air pollutants and irritants such as smoking. These are the some reasons for asthma. And next, emphysema. The main cause of emphysema is smoking of tobacco. Emphysema. Next, symptoms. Chronic disorder. It is a chronic disorder. That means it lasts for a long time. An illness lasts, L-A-S-T-S, lasts for a long time. That is called chronic disorder. In this case, alveolar walls are damaged and their walls collapse. That means fusion of originally separate parts merge or fuse or mix or mingle, due to which respiratory surface area of gases is decreased. Whenever the walls of alveoli are fused together, then the surface area for exchange of gases is automatically decreased. Lungs shows larger, but fewer alveoli, because some alveoli get fused together, so that the number of alveoli decreases. But lungs shows larger, and moreover, more fibrous and less elastic. They become more fibrous and less elastic, so that shortness of breath occurs. What is shortness of breath? An uncomfortable condition that make it difficult to fully get air into our lungs. This condition actually called shortness of breath. It is very dangerous situation. So we can see all these characters, symptoms in emphysema. Next, bronchitis. What are the reasons for bronchitis? Maybe a virus, a cold or flu virus, or maybe a bacterium. And exposure to substances that irritate the lungs, such as tobacco smoke, dust, fumes, vapors, and air pollution. These are the reasons for bronchitis. What are the characteristics or symptoms that we can see in this condition, bronchitis? Inflammation of bronchi, the swollen condition of bronchi, swelling of mucus lining of bronchi, increased mucus production, decrease in the diameter of bronchi. Whenever the mucus is accumulated or deposited in the bronchi, in the lumen of bronchi, then automatically the diameter of bronchi will be decreased. Whenever, because of the increased production of mucus, it is accumulated, it is deposited in the lumen of bronchi, so that the diameter of bronchi is decreased. Apart from this, it can also obstruct the passage of air through the bronchi also. Okay, chronic cough with thick mucus, that means sputum or phlegm. Sputum or phlegm. Next, pneumonia. Pneumonia, another respiratory disease which occurs in human, pneumonia, and also in animals also. Causes: infection of lungs by bacteria such as Streptococcus pneumoniae. Infection of lungs by bacteria such as Streptococcus pneumoniae, and also by certain viruses, for example, viral pneumonia, then it is called viral pneumonia. If pneumonia is caused by virus, in such condition, that pneumonia is called viral pneumonia, caused by influenza virus and respiratory syncytial virus. This is also, this information is also not mentioned in your textbook, so that you need to note down all these points. RSV. RSV means respiratory syncytial virus. And it also caused by fungi, protozoans, and mycoplasmas. Mycoplasmas, a kind of a group of bacteria. Actually, mycoplasmas means a group of bacteria, the Mycoplasma pneumoniae. The scientific name of that bacteria which causes pneumonia is Mycoplasma pneumoniae. So mycoplasmas means a group of bacteria. These are all the causes for pneumonia. And what are the symptoms of pneumonia? Inflammation of lungs, accumulation of mucus in alveoli, impaired exchange of gas due to accumulation or deposition of large amount of mucus in alveoli. It obstructs the process of exchange of gases. It obstructs the diffusion process. Impaired, that is called impaired exchange of gases or disabled exchange of gases, and leading to death if untreated. Leading to death if untreated. Most dreadful, most dangerous disease it is, caused by Streptococcus pneumoniae or virus, influenza virus or RSV virus or mycoplasmas, fungi, protozoans, some kind of protozoans. Okay. Next, COPDs. Usually emphysema, chronic bronchitis, and asthma come under chronic obstructive pulmonary diseases. This is a full form of COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary diseases. Next, occupational respiratory diseases. Number one, asbestosis. Asbestosis. It is due to chronic exposure, that means long-term exposure to asbestos dust in the people working in asbestos industry. What are the symptoms in asbestosis? Shortness of breath, tightness in chest, chest pain, and appetite loss. Appetite means hunger. Appetite loss. And silicosis. It occurs because of long-term exposure to silica dust in the people working in mining industries and quarries. Okay, it occurs because of long-term exposure to silica dust in the people working in mining industries and quarries. What are the symptoms? Dyspnea means shortness of breath or difficulty in breathing. Dyspnea means shortness of breath or difficult in breathing. Next, cough, fatigue, extreme tiredness. Fatigue means extreme tiredness, weight loss, chest pain, gradual darkening of skin, fever, etc. These are the symptoms in silicosis. Next, siderosis. It occurs due to deposition of iron particles in tissues. The main cause of siderosis, there are several types of siderosis actually. The main cause of siderosis is due to deposition of iron particles in tissues. Different types of siderosis. Number one, pneumoconiosis, due to inhalation of iron particles. Number two, hyperferemia, due to the presence of excess iron in the blood. The symptoms, recurrent alveolar hemorrhage, recurrent, that means repeated, frequently, more often, alveolar hemorrhage, that means bleeding. Next, hemosiderosis, pulmonary hemosiderosis. We are talking about pulmonary, lung-related hemosiderosis. It also occurs due to excess amount of iron that remains in the lungs. Symptoms, repeated intra-alveolar bleeding, that means hemorrhage. Next, black lung disease, developed from inhalation of coal dust. It is very common in long time coal mine workers. Symptoms, cough and with or without black sputum or phlegm. Cough with or without black sputum or phlegm. Next, shortness of breath, chest tightness. These are the symptoms in black lung disease. Now, we completed the total lesson, breathing and exchange of gases. And I am going to discuss about, another topic, body fluids and circulation. Body fluids and circulation. Second unit, first lesson, body fluids and circulation. Okay, I will discuss about some important points in introductory part. The third integrating system, come the postman, come the policeman. Our circulatory system can be considered as the third integrating system, come the postman, come the policeman. If you want to understand why we consider the circulatory system as an integrating system and it can also act as the postman job and it can also act as the policeman duty. If you want to understand all these things, you should recall. You should know the functions of our circulatory system. What is the need and necessity of circulatory system? Okay, point number one. to carry nutrients and oxygen to the body parts. So the postman job, to carry nutrients and oxygen to the body parts. So the postman job. And to collect wastes and carbon dioxide from the tissues and carry them to the excretory organs to eliminate them. Excretory organs, that means kidneys, lungs, CO2 carry to lungs, and nitrogenous wastes and nitrogenous substances, urea and other wastes will carry to the lungs. So this is also postman job. And next, to collect hormones from the endocrine glands, tissues and carry them to target organs or target tissues for control and coordination of various processes. So it can act as integrating system and performs postman job. Integrating system. What does it mean? Integrating. Integrating means coordinating. Integrating means coordinating. This is the blood circulatory system is considered as third integratory system. What are the first and second integratory systems in our body? The first integratory system is nervous system. And second integratory system is endocrine system. And that circulatory system is the third endocrine system, third integrating system, because it collects the chemical messengers. Hormones are chemical messengers. It collects, the blood collects hormones, the chemical messengers from the endocrine glands or endocrine tissues and carry them to target organs and target tissues for control and coordination of various processes. So it can act as integrating system and performs postman job. You have already studied in 10th class the control and coordination in life processes. Which systems are responsible for control and coordination to perform a process called digestion? You have already studied the nervous system, muscular system, circulatory system. These are all systems work together and help to perform the total process digestion. So we can say that that blood circulatory system in our body is nothing but the third integratory system. Next, blood transport heat throughout the body in order to maintain uniform temperature in all the parts of the body. Yes, in some parts of our body more heat is produced. In some parts of our body less heat is produced, but we need to maintain a uniform temperature, that is about 98.4 degrees of Fahrenheit or 37.2 degrees of centigrade, of course. So blood transport the heat from the areas where the more heat is produced throughout the body in order to maintain uniform temperature in all the parts of the body. Apart from this, protection of the body by WBC. Antibodies and other proteins that circulate in the blood and defend the body against foreign microbes and toxic substances, foreign particles, harmful microorganisms, foreign particles and toxic substances. That means poisonous substances. So it can act, it can also act as the policeman job, because protection of the body. Next, various types of phagocytes also involve in protection of body against harmful microbes, perform policeman job. Okay. Phagocytes performs phagocytosis. The WBC, if some kind of WBC will enter into the tissues, then they are called phagocytes. They perform phagocytosis. Harmful substances, harmful microorganisms, toxic substances are engulfed by these phagocytes. That process is called phagocytosis. So blood will also perform the policeman job. So moreover, blood contains several types of proteins. Number one, albumins. These albumins provide capillary osmotic pressure to prevent excessive loss of fluids from blood and help maintain its normal consistency. That capillary osmotic pressure, is provided by certain proteins. Those are called albumins. What is the purpose to maintain that capillary osmotic pressure? To prevent excessive loss of fluids from blood and help maintain its normal consistency, induced by proteins, most probably by albumins. And globulins, actually globulins are of three types: alpha globulins, beta globulins, and gamma globulins. Alpha and beta globulins are transport proteins, whereas gamma globulins have a vital role, have an important role in natural and acquired immunity to infections, to various kinds of infections. Gamma globulins have a vital role in natural and acquired immunity to infection. Next, fibrinogen and prothrombin. Actually, these two kinds of inactive proteins, actually fibrinogen, the active form of fibrinogen is fibrin, the active form of prothrombin is thrombin. Okay, these inactive forms of fibrin and thrombin actually synthesized by liver and they enter the blood. These are blood clotting factors. The role of fibrinogen and prothrombin and the role of thrombocytes or blood platelets, these are all you studied actually in 10th class in the process of blood clotting. Okay, they play vital role in clotting of blood to prevent excessive bleeding when we are injured. Circulatory system, cardiovascular system, has a pumping station, pumping device, that is heart. From heart, the arterial blood reaches tissues. From there, the blood reaches to the heart again through veins, another kind of blood vessels, veins. Next, blood pressure is monitored by pressure sensors in the aorta. Pressure sensors, that means pressure detectors. And volume of blood, not bold, please ignore the typos, blood. The volume of blood is controlled by ADH, antidiuretic hormones. and aldosterone, anti-diuretic hormone, ADH or vasopressin, and aldosterone, also called as aldosterone. These two hormones actually, vasopressin and aldosterone, are synthesized by hypothalamus and releases into the pituitary, the anterior lobe of pituitary, and there they stored whenever the need and necessity, they will secrete into the bloodstream and reach the target organs, vasopressin and aldosterone. Next, various methods for transportation of substances between body parts. You see, observe here, simple organisms like sponges, that means porifera, protozoans, and cnidarians, the phylum Cnidaria, circulate water drawn from their surroundings through the body cavities. You remember, you recall that sponges have ostia, numerous pores in the body wall. Through these ostia, continuously water enter the body cavity, that is called a spongocele, and that water is sent out through the anterior large pore. That pore is called osculum. You studied in first year intermediate course. That total system is called canal system. It is the unique feature of sponges. It is the unique feature of sponges, canal system. With the help of this canal system, the circulation of materials occurs. And what about cnidarians? In cnidarians, for example, you can take hydra. In that hydra, in cnidarians, the central body cavity is called gastrovascular cavity. It opens out through only one pore, anteriorly only one pore. It is not called as a mouth or anus, only one pore. Water enters through this pore and water is sent out through this pore. So that gastrovascular cavity circulate water drawn from their surroundings through the body cavities. And what about the higher animals, higher organisms? That means more complicated, organized organisms. They have more complicated, organized body. The organization of body is more complex. And what about more complex organisms? They use special circulatory fluids and circulatory systems within their bodies to transport various materials. Okay, we all know that blood is the most commonly used circulatory fluid by most of the higher animals, including the humans. In addition to the blood, another fluid, lymph, also help in the transportation of certain substances in higher animals. So, blood and lymph together constitute the fluid tissues in the human body. From 9th class onwards, you are studying the blood in 9th class, 10th class, and also in first year intermediate. Blood is a connective fluid tissue you have studied. So in addition to that blood, in higher animals, including human body, there is a special circulatory fluid that is called lymph. So blood and lymph together constitute the fluid connective tissues in the human body. Okay, lymphatic system. First of all, I will discuss about lymphatic system. okay, lymphatic system. It is a vast network of thin-walled vessels that arise as blind-ended lymph capillaries in most of the tissues of the body. And these capillaries starts with the lymphatic system starts with blind-ended lymph capillaries in the tissues. An extensive network of extensive, vast means extensive network of thin-walled vessels that arise as blind-ended vessels in most of the tissues of the body. Okay, lymphatic system is a part of circulatory system, have a network of interconnected tubes known as lymph vessels. Lymph capillaries merge together and forms large lymphatic vessels, which lead into large lymph ducts. So, that lymphatic system starts with lymph capillaries in the tissues. These lymph capillaries merge together and forms large vessels. These vessels are called lymphatic vessels, which lead into larger lymph ducts. The similarity between the walls of the nature of veins and lymph vessels. The walls of lymph vessels and ducts, that means lymph ducts, are similar to those of veins. Both are provided with valves to prevent the backflow of lymph. Lymph vessels and lymph ducts are provided with valves to prevent the backflow of lymph. In arteries, there is no valves. The valves are absent in arteries because there is a pumping device, pumping station. Time to time, it sends some amount of blood into the arteries with some pressure, so that no need of valves in arteries. Whereas in lymph ducts and lymph vessels, valves are necessary because there is no pumping device to send that blood in the valves, blood in the veins, and lymph in the lymph vessels. No pumping station, no pumping device. No, these are not pressurized. Lymph ducts and lymph vessels and also the veins are not pressurized, so that valves are present in the lumen of these vessels, ducts and veins, to prevent the backflow of lymph. That is the similarity in between veins and lymph ducts. The smooth muscles in the walls of the lymph vessels and ducts cause peristaltic waves of contraction, pushing lymph towards the neck region. For example, the lymph from our lower parts of the body travels against the gravity and towards heart, so that these peristaltic waves, the smooth muscles in the walls of lymph vessels and ducts cause peristaltic waves of contraction, pushing lymph towards the neck region, that means towards the heart. For that peristaltic waves are very much useful by the smooth muscles in the walls of lymph vessels and ducts. Moreover, that valves will help to prevent the backflow of lymph. Okay, what is lymph? How it forms? The relationship between blood capillaries and lymphatic capillaries and ECF. What is ECF? See this picture and observe carefully. Listen to me carefully. This is arteriole. You see, from heart, the main aorta comes out of the heart. That aortic arch is divided into so many arteries. Next, each and every artery again divided into so many arterioles, relatively very small arteries. After the entry of this arteriole into the tissue, these are the tissue cells. After the entry of these arterioles into the tissue, what will happen? That arteriole again divided into so many hair-like fine blood vessels. These are called capillaries. The interconnected, the network of capillaries. These red colored structures are called blood capillaries. Okay. These blood capillaries of arteriole joins with these capillaries, these light blue colored capillaries, joins with these capillaries. These capillaries joins together and forms venule. Venules constitute together, join together and forms veins. Small veins are joins together and forms large veins. For example, post-caval veins, pre-caval veins, pulmonary veins, like that. They enter into the heart. So, these capillaries are this important, most important point. It is these capillaries of arteriole and venule. These capillaries are completely interconnected. Okay. These light colored network of capillaries are called lymph capillaries. They start in tissues. This is blind-ended vessels. Observe here, blind-ended. They starts with the blind-ended vessels. Lymphatic system starts with the blind-ended small vessels. This is the network of these lymph capillaries, and lymph vessels are formed, and lymph ducts are formed. These lymph ducts are enter the venous system. Okay, later we will discuss that. These are the tissue cells. This is the relationship between blood capillaries and lymphatic capillaries and ECF. Okay. Okay. Now, observe this flow chart. What is lymph and how it forms? Blood in the arteriolar, this is T, arteriolar ends of capillaries. Blood in the arteriolar ends of capillaries. These contents: plasma, glucose, inorganic salts, and small-sized organic molecules oozes out of the arteriolar capillaries into the intercellular spaces due to high filtration pressure. Listen to me carefully once again. These substances oozes out of the arteriolar ends of capillaries into the intercellular spaces. That is because of high filtration pressure. That filtered fluid into the intracellular spaces called ECF. ECF means extracellular fluid outside the cells, in between the intercellular spaces. That fluid is called extracellular fluid. From this extracellular fluid, oxygen enter into the cells. Nutrients, not please ignore the typos. It is not correct. Nutrients. From this extracellular fluid, nutrients means salts, vitamins, minerals, and the end products of carbohydrates, glucose, the end products of proteins, amino acids, and the end products of fats, fatty acids, and glycerol. These are the nutrients which we require. These nutrients, oxygen, enter the cells, and this carbon dioxide and nitrogenous compounds as well as other wastes in the tissues diffuses into the ECF. From ECF, oxygen and nutrients are diffused into the tissue cells. At the same time, because of the high concentration of nitrogenous wastes and high concentration of carbon dioxide in the tissue cells, these substances automatically diffused into the extracellular fluid. Okay, after that, due to increased colloid pressure exerted by plasma proteins, 85% of ECF will enter into the capillaries at the venular ends. About 80% of ECF will enter into the capillaries at the venular ends. And what about the 15% of ECF? Yes, it is called lymph. The remaining 50% of ECF is called lymph, which is collected through lymph capillaries into the lymphatic system. Finally, it reaches venous system. Okay, that is called lymph. The remaining 15% of extracellular fluid, actually, it is from the blood. It is from the blood plasma. Actually, ECF is similar to the blood plasma. It is forming from blood. So, the remaining 15% of extracellular fluid is called lymph, which is collected through lymph capillaries into the lymphatic system. Finally, it reaches venous system. Next, you see this diagram. It is not mentioned in your textbook, so that you need to draw this diagram also. Relation between blood circulatory system and lymphatic system. You see, this is the network of capillaries in the tissue. These are the capillaries of arteriole, and these are the capillaries of the arteries from the heart, main aorta, arteries, and arteriole. Finally, arterioles, each and every arteriole divided into capillaries, and arteries ends with capillaries, whereas veins starts with capillaries. This is the capillary network of arteries and venules. From these venules, small veins are formed. Small veins are formed because of the fusion of these small veins forms large veins. For example, pre-caval vein or post-caval vein or pulmonary veins, they enter the heart. So this is complete interconnected system, closed type of circulatory system. Our blood circulatory system is closed type of circulatory system. And now you observe, what about these light green colored network of vessels? These are the lymphatic capillaries. Lymphatic capillaries, which starts in tissues with blind-ended vessels. These are lymph nodes. This is one node, then this is another node. Large lymphatic vessels, and they join the venous system, and that lymph enter the blood. Okay, the main circulation, enter to the main blood circulation. Okay. How lymph travels? In the form of a paragraph, it is mentioned in your textbook in the form of a paragraph, a large paragraph that is somehow confused. So that I prepared a flowchart. You can easily understand in the form of this flowchart, with the help of this flowchart. Okay, first, lymph vessels from the lower parts of the body. So lymph is collected from the lower parts of the body, lower organs of the body, from each and every tissue of the organs of the body. That lymph enter into the left lymphatic duct or chyliferous duct or thoracic duct. Lymph travels from the lower parts of the body, enter the thoracic duct. At the same time, the lymph which is collected from the left side of the head and the left arm and the parts of the chest, left side of the chest, left side of the head, and the left arm and the parts of the chest, that lymph, that fluid will also enter the thoracic duct. And what about this? The right side of the head, from the right side of the head, neck, right arm, and right part of the thorax, the lymph is collected through lymph vessels. That lymph enter the right lymphatic duct. This is left lymphatic duct, collects the lymph from the lower parts of the body and the left side of the head and left arm and the parts of the chest. That lymph enters the left lymphatic duct from the right side of the head, neck, right arm, and right part of the thorax. The lymph is collected through lymph vessels, enter the right lymphatic duct. The left and right lymphatic ducts opens into venous system. Superior vena cava, a large vein. That thoracic duct or left lymphatic duct joins at the junction of left internal jugular vein and left subclavian vein. And this right lymphatic duct join at the junction of right internal jugular vein and right subclavian vein. This left subclavian vein and right subclavian vein enters the venous system, that means superior vena cava. In this way, the lymph travels. These jugular veins, these are located in our neck. There are two sets of jugular veins. The left internal jugular vein, left external jugular vein, one set. And right internal jugular vein, right external jugular vein, another set. There are two sets of, totally two pairs of four jugular veins located in our heart. Okay, this is about the how lymph travels. Next, before lymph is returned to the heart via the venous system, bacteria, viruses, bacteria, plural, viruses, etc. are phagocytized by the WBC in the lymph nodes. Okay, lymphatic system also consists lymph tissues and nodes. What are they? Spleen, thymus gland, tonsils, bone marrow, lymph nodes. Particularly spleen, thymus and tonsils. Spleen, thymus and tonsils contain high concentrations of WBC and are able to identify and also destroy toxins in lymph fluid. Not only harmful chemical substances, not only toxins, they can also identify the foreign particles and foreign microorganisms which are very much harmful to our body. They can identify all these things and destroy them. Next, it transports lymphocytes from the lymphatic glands. Lymph returns the absorbed nutrients and waste from the body parts to the blood, and these are the functions of lymphatic system. And what about spleen? Do you know heading in a small box, very little information is mentioned in your textbook. And the spleen is located on the left side of the abdomen, under the ribs, above the stomach, in our abdomen. Moreover, left side of the abdomen, under the ribs and above the stomach, the location of spleen. Okay. And what is the size of spleen? It is the most important organ, spleen. It is about as big as our fist. Okay. Next, it is the largest lymphatic organ. Lymph, thymus gland, lymph nodes, and other tonsils, among all of them, it is the largest lymphatic organ. It is the reservoir of RBC and lymphocytes. It acts as a blood filter. Moreover, that lymph will act as a hemopoietic organism, hemopoietic organ in the fetus, the gestation, up to the fifth month of the gestation. In the fetus, it acts as a hemopoietic organ. That means blood corpuscles are generated from or produced from spleen. That means hemopoietic organ, just like in adults, bone marrow. That is bone marrow is nothing but hematopoietic organ. It produces several types of blood corpuscles. So spleen will act as a hematopoietic organ up to the fifth month of gestation period. And in adults, what about in adults? That old and the lifespan of RBC is about 120 days, nearly. The old, aged, dead, and damaged RBC are broken down in the spleen by large WBC. So, it acts as a hemolytic organ. And burial ground of RBC and graveyard of RBC. Most important two mass question about spleen, and also for your NEET exams, you remember all these things about spleen as a lymphatic organ. And next, one more thing. When the enlarged uterus, we usually see in pregnant ladies, pregnant women, their legs are somehow swollen. What is the reason behind that? Observe here. When the enlarged uterus during pregnancy, exerted pressure on the abdominal veins in a pregnant woman, capillary hydro, capillary hydrostatic pressure is increased. So, more fluid comes out of the veins. Because of the hydrostatic pressure. But because of the osmotic pressure, it prevents the water to flow outside of the cells. But whereas the hydrostatic pressure, if hydrostatic pressure is increased, more fluid comes out. Okay. Hence, it leads to, see here, what is the consequence? It leads to accumulation of extracellular fluid in legs. Hence, the swollen legs is edema. This condition is called edema. So, they need to walk. They need to do some works. Walking is the best exercise for pregnant women to avoid that edema condition. This is also studied in your textbook, in your 10th class, the edema condition. So, lymphatic system is considered as open circulatory system, not closed circulatory system. What are the reasons? Number one, these vessels do not form a full circulatory system. What is full circulatory system? Just I explained you with the help of a diagram. What about the blood circulatory system? The capillaries of arterioles and the capillaries of venules are completely interconnected. They are fused together. They are not open. But whereas in lymphatic system, these vessels do not form a full circulatory system. The vessels, small lymphatic vessels, starts in tissues with blind-ended vessels. So, one-way circulation. This is one-way circulation. Whereas in our blood circulatory system, it is a two-way circulation. Heart to the tissues and again tissues to the heart. But whereas in the case of venous system one way flow, one way direction we can see from tissues to the, from body organs to the heart only. So that it is not a closed type of a circulatory system. Fluid moving in one direction. Lymphatic fluids move more slowly than blood because they are not pressurized. There is no pumping device to, there is no pumping station to pump the, to send the lymph with some pressure. So lymphatic fluids move more slowly than blood because they are not pressurized. No pumping organ in this tissue. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you very much. You remember one thing, with the help of 3, 4 and 5 PPTs, I will send the 5th today's lesson PPT, I will send later. With the help of 1st and 2nd videos and with the help of 3rd, 4th and 5th PPTs, you must write notes and you draw very important diagrams like lungs, the diffusion process between alveoli and the blood capillaries. Such diagrams you have to draw, you have to practice. First of all, you have to write, you need to complete the notes first. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, this diagram, you see this diagram also, I forget, this tonsil, the location of tonsils in our buccal cavity, next thymus gland above the heart, and then spleen, this is below the ribs and above the stomach, the left side of the left side of the abdomen. These are lymph nodes, these are lymph nodes, these are lymph nodes and lymphatic vessels. Some parts you can identify and observe through this diagram. Okay. Thank you.